Chapter 1, verses 69 to 71. God has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us. The first part of Zechariah's song talked about God visiting his people. The second part rejoices in the fact that God has raised up a horn of salvation from the line of David. What is a horn of salvation anyway? Well, if you go out into nature, or if you live in a highly urbanized society like Singapore, to the zoo, horns are the things on usually powerful, non-predatory animals. And this is what gives them strength, such as the horn of a rhinoceros, a symbol of power and even terror to others around them. It's used the same way in Scripture. For example, look at Deuteronomy 33, verses 16 to 17, where talking about Joseph, it says, "He will be the prince of his brothers. He will be like a firstborn bull with the horns of a wild ox or a unicorn. And with this horn," it says, "he shall gore the peoples, every one of them, till the ends of the earth." That's kind of what horns are for, goring your enemies. And so Zechariah is thrilled that God will bring about the redemption of his people by choosing a horn from the line of David, meaning installing a king with great power to destroy the enemies, to deliver the people of God from the hand of those who hate and oppress them. Who are these enemies? Well, I'm not sure he's referring to the Romans or the Greeks or anything like that. The enemies of the people of God are simply all those who reject the gospel, all those who reject salvation, all those who reject the way of Jesus, those who live their own way, create their own nations, build their own power structures, leading to some level of selfishness and oppression. All those who reject God's salvation, by default, are the enemies. And Zechariah's hope is that this coming horned king will rescue God's people from their hand, protect them from those people, all those evil influences of the world. And I guess finally, he must be thinking, this is the king who will gore those enemies to death forever and ever. Now, isn't that a joyful thought?